All right. Well, sorry, Rob got cut off there. That happened to me yesterday before we even jumped into this conference. So I'm glad he was able to give us some input on it. So let's jump real quick. We can come back to the wrap up of his discussion piece shortly. Francisco, take it away. I know we've had several discussions about the Delta and wanted to share and get some of your history and input from the region.
Thank you, Nathan. What I had prepared or what I had in mind was to share a video. I don't know how many of you have seen it, but it's something we did with our partners in the Delta a few years ago. And that video provides a really good summary of the overall restoration efforts in the Colorado River Delta. And then I wanted to follow up with just a few slides to show the specific areas where, there are underground restoration efforts.
Excellent.
Is that okay, Nathan?
Absolutely. Yeah, this is your show. So we're excited to see it.
Okay, let me try to open the video here. Okay, and then let me see if I can share. Where is it here?
Nature at work.
Let me know. Can you see it now?
Just audio. We don't have the visual.
Witnessing the forces
how
of
about
nature at
how about
work.
now?
There's nothing like it.
No?
Not yet.
You didn't see the video? I sent you the link, Nathan. I don't know
This is
if
Horacio. I have it here. I'm going to play it back from my screen. Stand by.
Okay.
That'd be the second link in there. Thank you, Hersha.
Witnessing the forces of nature at work, there's nothing like it. When allowed, nature has immense power to restore its own balance, to find its own rhythm with the world as it should be, and with all the creatures that inhabit it. This is the awesome process that has just occurred in the Colorado River Delta.
It was an amazing experience to see the river coming alive again.
We demonstrated that it's possible.
This is a precedent. This is a model that people are watching from all over the world.
One of the great rivers of the world, the Colorado River flows some 1,450 miles from the western slopes of the Colorado Rockies onward to its delta. 100 years ago, the delta was a massive, lush region spanning more than 3,000 square miles, filled with native vegetation and home to more than 300 species of birds and animals that supported a way of life for the people who lived there.
It seems strange that you would have all of these green, lush areas growing in the middle of the desert, but that's exactly what used to be here, 100 years ago.
The Colorado River is North America's great desert river, but for the last 50 years, it has not reached its delta or the sea, instead draining away into a sandy desert south of the Mexican border. The parched and withered delta is just a whisper of its former self. The unrelenting quest by humans to grow and tame the forces of nature are largely responsible for its plight. Layer on the effects of a changing climate, and we have a catastrophic natural disaster on our hands. Humans can certainly harm, but humans can also help. Inspired by nature's resilience and the knowledge that a small amount of water can rekindle life, a binational restoration effort in the Delta was launched in the 1990s. The work of nonprofit groups, government agencies, community leaders, and others helped inspire an historic agreement in 2012 between the governments of Mexico and the United States, called Minute 319, the U.S. and Mexico agreed that working together to save the Delta with more regular water flows was an important priority.
We, as citizens of the Colorado River watershed, decided that this is what we wanted to do, and we made it happen.
In March 2014, the time for action had come. Beginning at the Morales Dam, located on the U.S.-Mexico border, an unprecedented surge of water called a pulse flow began its historic journey into the Delta, an event intended to mimic the natural spring flooding that used to take place annually in this region. As the gates of the dam opened, U.S. and Mexican officials celebrated the beginning of this unique experiment. Years of work had cemented a new binational partnership, a model of cooperation for all the world to see.
We were there to witness, no? And when they opened the gates and the river was alive, and it's a complete excitement to everybody.
Watching the water surge past the dam and discovering once again its rightful path towards the sea was a sight to behold.
We weren't just running a demonstration. We were creating a river.
How often have humans witnessed a river being reborn? Inch by inch, foot by foot, mile by mile, in an awesome demonstration of the force of nature, the Colorado River was reclaiming its corridor.
It's a fantastic feeling to have a river running again.
Within days, the surge of fresh water had transformed a dry riverbed at San Luis Rio, Colorado, a small Mexican community south of the border, into a river almost 8 feet deep in parts.
Most of the time, the riverbed is dry, but as you can see now, you know, there is water coming in the river, and you know, the water attracts people from the local communities here. So that's why this area is very important, because people get connected again with the river. You know, kids especially, they haven't seen the water here, so this might be the first time for them to see water here in the river.
The response of the people was amazing. I think that was probably the best surprise, you know, how the communities embraced the river coming back.
Astonished to find a river in their neighborhood, children and families celebrated the return of water and all the joy a natural resource can bring.
Yo lo considero así, fuera una bendición que pudiéramos tener agua ya constantemente aquí en el río Colorado.
La agua es vida.
The local reaction to seeing the river conjured back to life in the Delta was really beyond all of our expectations.
8 weeks later, on May 15th, 2014, the water pulse reached the sea in an exhilarating reconnection, an event that had not happened regularly in at least half a century. From the air, it appeared as if the tidal waters of the upper Gulf of California extended its salty fingers to touch once again the cool, fresh water of the Colorado River. Despite all the obstacles, nature had found a way. History was made. The magnificent forces of nature were hard at work once again, for all to see. Water-laden air attracted birds and wildlife to the region like a magnet. It was an invitation to congregate. Recently planted native cottonwoods and willows sprang to life, launching their seedlings in a slow-motion dance. Given the experimental nature of the pulse flow, it will take time to fully understand its benefits and impact on the region.
while the scientists are going to have much to tell us over the next few years about what the ecosystem response is and the groundwater response and how the water moved through the river, a lot of what we had to learn from the pulse flow is what we saw in the human response to what it looked like to move that water into that river channel again.
Of the 260 rivers that cross or form international boundaries, this is the world's first water allocation for the environment.
We had the opportunity today to build on our binational partnership to make water flows to the Delta region a regular occurrence once again. The future of this region's economy depends on it, as do the lives of the people and communities near the river.
We have two countries, the United States and Mexico, coming together in a collaborative way saying we are deliberately going to put some of this river's water to use to support nature, to support a healthy river, and to support everything that lives depending on that river.
It's the beginning of a whole new process, no? To show that we are in a new era of the Colorado River.
Join us in this unique effort to restore life to the Delta. Help us continue the positive change underway. Share the excitement that has captivated people on both sides of the border. You too can become part of this restoration effort. Learn more at raisetheriver.org.
Thank you. Nathan, I want to just to add a few things, because the video was produced in, I think it was, 2014, 2015. So it has been, a few years since then. So I just have a few slides just to show a couple maps and images about, the underground restoration effort. So I'm going to share my screen here.
Yeah, that's great. Can you talk quickly about the process of that agreement too? Because that's at the scale that we're talking about now too, is the agreement, I think it was it 319, the agreement that started the process?
Yeah, that is correct. It took several years and I would say that the foundation of that goes back to the late 90s, mm-hmm. and the first minute was Minute 306, I think it was signed in 2000 or 2002. I think it was December, November 2000. Anyway, I think what I can say is that it took several years. It involved not only the country of Mexico and the US, but also the states on both sides of the border. And from NGOs, we were able to participate and contribute. Even though the minute has a component on the environment, there were many more components on water conservation. So I only show the component on the environment, but there were many projects many components of the agreement. On water conservation and how Mexico and the U.S. Were committed to manage the river. So it is very important, a very important agreement, not only for the environment, but for overall water management in the Colorado River. So what I'd like to show here, Sonoran Institute is just one of several organizations working in the Delta, and we have formed what we call the Raise the River group. And so we are six organizations. And again, Sonoran Institute is just one of them. But we work throughout the Delta. In terms of what Sonoran Institute is doing, we do a lot of underground restoration, but we also work a lot with the communities, trying to connect people with nature and of course reconnect the river with the sea. We do have programs, working with kids. We go to the school And then we bring the kids to the field so that they get in contact with nature. So it's a very intensive kind of environmental education program, visiting schools and doing field trips. Of course, with the pandemic, we have been able to do that in the last year, but we used to do this. And of course, once we can do it, we'll do it again. We have more than 3,000 to 4,000 visitors to our restoration site every year. And we, of course, organize reforestation days. And this is something new we just launched a month ago, actually, in February, early February. This is a new environmental education platform. Because of COVID, we wanted to reach out to the schools too and offer an opportunity for teachers and kids to learn about the Delta. So we did that, and you can find that. It is in Spanish now, but I think we're working on having this available in English too. So the environmental education component is a major component of our efforts. In terms of the restoration, we do restoration not only for wildlife, but also for the people. So that's an important component. We want to have an impact and benefit the people. And just a few more slides on the with some maps indicating the areas where we are working. Sonoran Institute, ProNatura Noroeste, and Restauremos el Colorado are the three organizations doing on-the-ground restoration. And we do that in different areas of the Delta. And Sonoran Institute is working on the central part of the Delta and in the estuary and the Rio Jardí. So this is the central part. We call it Laguna Grande. And we have already about 250 hectares, so about 700 acres of habitat that has been restored. You see those in green in that map. And then the red one, the red polygons are something we're gonna be doing this year. So about 80 acres more this year. And all the orange areas are available for restoration. So we have plenty of areas still available for restoration, only in this particular central part of the Delta. There, just an example, this is a visitor center that we established a couple of years ago. And this is kind of the where we bring the students and the visitors. And from that place, we go into the different restoration areas. So it's important for us. So we are hoping to expand all the restoration, not only the restoration, but also the environmental education activities. So this is just a render of a master plan that we are developing for this particular site, Laguna Grande. We're increasing the infrastructure for visitors, creating a birdwatching tower, inside the forest. This particular area is the largest forest of cottonwood and willow on the Mexican side of the Colorado River. So it's a very important component of the overall restoration. And this is just a map showing all that central part of the Delta. It's part of the Laguna Grande, but it also has other polygons that other organizations, Restauremos el Colorado, is working. So all this part of the Delta, we're gonna have probably close to 2,000 or more acres of restored habitat in the next few years, plus, adjacent areas. So when you count everything, you'll probably have closer to 5,000 acres. But the 2,000 is what we call active, very active restoration efforts. We also have another project in the Cucapa along the Rio Jardí. The Rio Jardí is very important because it's the only river in Baja California that has water throughout the year. And this water is coming from agricultural return flows, but also wastewater, treated wastewater from Las Arenitas treatment plant and wetland complex. So we're working with the Cucapa. We began the project, but we haven't been able to really plan to it because we're in the process of getting the permits. And also because of COVID, we had to delay this also because of COVID. what you see here at the left, at the bottom, is the Cucapail Mayor community. But again, we're working with the members of the tribe, not only the adults, but the kids. We're asking them, how would you like to see the river, why the river is important, and they are helping us. So it's not that we come and do what we, you know, the technical project. No, I mean, we take the time to work with the community, get the feedback, their input, and then with them, we develop the design of the project. And I think this is probably the last slide. This one, you know, it's specific on the estuary and probably is more, perhaps more relevant to the conversation. So for many years, we have been trying to reconnect the river with the sea, and sedimentation or sediments filling up the main channel was a major constraint or major obstacle for tides to come in into upstream areas. Do you see my cursor here? Does it show? Okay, so tides were coming here, but because of this, what you see here in pink and yellow is the main channel, and we have dredged those, it's close to 20 kilometers, so that's what, 8 miles probably, or 7 miles that we've done, we have dredged. And when I said that, it's only about 2 meters wide and half a meter, maybe a little more deep. So it's not dredging the entire channel. It's just, enough for the tides to come in and for the water that's coming from the Rio Jardí and from the Ayala drain to come, to be able to, you know, meet the seawater and mix in these areas. And the goal is some of that water will go into Lagoon 1 or Lagoon 2, Lagoon 3, and Lagoon 4. In fact, Lagoon 4 is already getting water. And in high tides, Lagoon 3 is filled with water, sometimes goes into Lagoon 2, but then the water stays there. And, you know, salinities, we have measured salinities in Lagoon 3 up to 80 or 90 parts per thousand. So pretty, you know, twice or even more the seawater salinity. So anyway, again, there is water coming from the Jardí River, from the Ayala drain, and this is the main Color River channel. And it's working. You know, we have seen more days where there is a connection. We have seen some marine species on upstream, I mean, on this particular area, shrimp. We have seen dolphins a little lower than here, maybe a few miles from where the cursor is. We have seen dolphins and sea lions there. And I know because I was there, so nobody told me about it. I actually took a picture of those. So from it doesn't show in this map, but from where my cursor here is at the bottom of the map to the mouth of the river, it's about 10 to 12 miles. So it's not near. I mean, we're talking about 10 to 15 miles, if river miles, you know. So again, this is what our goal is in terms of enhancing estuary habitat, these lagoons, and of course along the main channel. If we are able to do that, you know, in the past they used to see this is what we call the Kigni area, and this is the Jardí River. In fact, the Rio Colorado used to meet the Jardí River here. In fact, there is a couple of locations where there used to be that connection. But in near Campo Muñoz, Campo Mosqueda, they used to see sea turtles and dolphins and be able to just, you know, grab a fish almost from the river. So we know that at one point there was that connectivity. So if we are able to reestablish the connectivity in this particular area where we know it was lost, of course the goal or the expectation is that some of the species will be able to get into the Jardí River and find, you know, additional habitat. So that is why this particular area is very important for us. And we do have a restoration plan for the estuary that we are hoping to publish in the next couple of months. We're just finalizing that. So anyway, I'm gonna leave it there so that there is time for questions or comments, feedback. So thank you.
Yeah, I don't see any questions dropped in yet, but I'll look on our other platform. Quick question on those lagoons. You said it was a hyper saline, like double or triple sometimes the salinity level that you might see elsewhere in the ocean. That's not a negative impact then, right? Most of those species would know not to go into the hypersaline areas and would turn around, or is there an intention behind it? Maybe you can give me a little bit of background.
Well, these, especially lagoon 3, it gets water in high tides, but the water doesn't drain out. It stays there. And that's not a something that we are trying to prevent that or to improve the conditions. We want water to get in and out of these lagoons. We would like to, we know that the salinity of the water coming in is about 40 parts per thousand. So we wanna be able to at least stay about that, or if we can, a little lower than that in Lagoon 3, in every of these three. In fact, Lagoon 1 is, it gets the most fresh water. So salinity there is a lot lower than seawater, but Lagoon 3 and 2 are the ones that are more complicated in terms of being able to lower the salinity. But yeah, so we don't want to have high salinity in these lagoons. We want to reduce the salinity.
The intention is to get water in there first, start the restoration process and connectivity, and then over time develop a way to reduce the salinity as the system is evolving. Okay, that makes sense.
Yeah, we, for example, hopefully this year we'll be enhancing the connection or the connectivity between the river here and Lagoon 3. So the idea is that more frequently Lagoon 3 will get water, and both seawater and some of the not necessarily fresh water, but the mixed water coming from upstream, some of that water will be able to go in and hopefully go out. So that's the first simple or easy next step. If that doesn't work, another thing that we have identified is, you know, dredge some channels or canals inside Lagoon 3 to enhance the water, I mean, to facilitate, I guess, the flow of the water coming in and out. And it doesn't show in the map, but on the south portion of Lagoon 3, there is also a channel coming in. Sometimes the water from the tides is coming from the south into Lagoon 3. So anyway, we are hoping this year we'll be doing that and also a connection with Lagoon 1. But again, we have seen an increase in the number of days where we see a connectivity, you know, of fresh water and seawater from... You know, I think back in the, I think it's 2013 or, you know, from 15, 20 days. And now we're looking at 140, 150 days. And so we know the dredging that we've done, plus, you know, additional water from the Rio Jardí is working. It's improving the conditions in that part of the Delta.
And the last question real quick, you said there was another report or another master plan that you're coming out with. Is that specific to the Delta? Can you mention that again?
Yeah, that one is a restoration plan for the estuary for this part of the Delta. It's in draft. It's in final revision now. And in fact, I think we have it in Spanish and we'll be translating that or to English or vice versa. So... But I think it will be able to make it available, I want to say, in April.
Yeah, and you mentioned, I think, with any of these two projects, massive projects, but the success of it comes from multi-agency collaborations, right? And not one agency is equipped to have all of the skill sets to achieve the project. And I think that's what garnered a lot of the success of these occurring, is that you have teams on the ground that are ready to do the work. You have teams like yours doing the planning and engineering and feasibility of everything. And NGOs and other nonprofits and political agencies are all collaborating. I think that's the message that we're bringing forward with these large projects and restoration efforts. It's going to take those kind of teamwork efforts to get any projects done?
Yeah, there are more than 40 different agencies or entities participating at different levels, of course. The binational group itself, the Environmental Working Group, you know, I think we have over 20, 25 different agencies. And of course, funding is coming from also from different sources. There is the funding to the binational agreement, but it's also private funding. You know, the NGOs working in the area, including Sonoran Institute, we have been able to receive funding from different foundations to implement the work. And so that's another important factor.
That's great. Thank you so much, Francisco. Congratulations again. You received a promotion at the Sonoran Institute a couple months ago, so I was excited to hear that. I'm excited to keep in touch with you and keep collaborating. Hopefully, you know, if there's some funding that could be generated for, you know, feasibility study of the larger restoration of Laguna Salada, that there might be a collaboration opportunity there as well.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Nathan. My pleasure.
All right. Thank you so much. Have a great day.